First overtime win from over Michigan for Iowa since January 1st, 2017. That's crazy. This was a
Good evening, everybody. That's how it sounded on ESPN2 at the end. Welcome in, Michigan Basketball Postgame Live. Dennis Fithian with you. We're ready to tip this one up late night on a Thursday in a good basketball game out there in Iowa City. It doesn't happen for Michigan. This one for U of M, they could smell a road Big Ten victory. They can taste a Big Ten road victory, and they had it right in their hands late in the game, but they were not able to make the key plays, more key plays than Iowa down the stretch, and they end up losing in overtime with a 93-84 score going to Iowa. Iowa scoring the first 8 points in overtime, and that was the ball game. So here we are, ready to talk about it. You want to join us? You can always do that and leave your feedback. Most times I open the lines up on Twitter, where you're able to go there. You follow me on Twitter, and you can jump in and talk about it. And that's going on right now. So that's happening for you. Well, let's talk about this game. I'll give you my thoughts. It was a very exciting game, you know. John Crispin, he can be at times I've listened to him and I thought, man, this guy is annoying. And he wasn't really annoying me tonight. And I almost where I was like, oh, this guy isn't all that bad. And then they said it was John Crispin. I'm like, oh, that's surprising, because a lot of times he's annoying me, and he wasn't really annoying tonight. Maybe it was just the brand of basketball. It was good. Michigan came out and, you know, they were hitting everything, and Jet Howard, you know, had a career night. And then you thought, well, maybe that's just going to be, you know, one half. But Michigan came out and they played well in the second half. And they were right in position. As I'll go over, if you didn't have to, maybe you're listening to this after the fact, you didn't see it at all. You know, Michigan was in position to win this game, in great position to win this game. And they gave up a 4-point play with under 30 seconds to go. That was the key play in this game. You're up four with the. You're up four with, under 30 seconds to play. You're feeling pretty good. And no, you should feel pretty good, you know, executing, make some free throws. And, you know, you don't want to give up a 4-point play. How about that? You heard that here first. But let's go over it a little bit. Enough with me jabbering on about it. Let's just give you the facts in this game. 93-84 overtime win for Iowa. They moved to 11-6 overall, and they even up their conference record at 3-3. Michigan, they dropped to 3-2 in the conference. They're now 9-7 overall heading into this game. You know, Iowa was a 6-point favorite. Michigan checked in at a 50 in KenPom's ratings. He updates those every day. Iowa was ahead of Michigan KenPom wise at 39. So there you go. The stage was set, and you know, Michigan gets up three at the half. They're 7-3 from downtown, and Jet Howard was spectacular. Yeah, he came out and he was throwing it in from downtown, 5-5 from 3-point land. He was throwing crossovers. He had the ball on a string. He was taking it to the hole to the tune of a 21-point outburst in the first half that tied his career high in just the first half. And you're like, wow, man, a 21 piece in the first half. Nice job there by Jet. Hunter Dickinson had 9 points. Michigan with Jet scoring 21 and Michigan with 43 points. Jet had 21. The entire rest of the Michigan team just had 22 points. Chris Murray, the outstanding southpaw there for the Hawkeyes, had 15 in the first half. Keegan Murray's a twin, and he's playing. It's amazing that Chris Murray, you know, didn't look anything like Keegan Murray. I mean, no, he looked like him, but he wasn't playing like him. Of course he looks like him. They're identical twins. He didn't play really like him last year, but now he's playing. Now he looks and plays like Keegan Murray. That took me a long time to spit out. But you'd have to agree with the way he's been playing, and he continued that tonight. Now, in this game, you get to the second half, and I like the one lineup. This was different than I've seen from Michigan and Juwan Howard all year long. They had Hunter Dickinson out there, and they played the freshman big, Terrace Reed Jr., who played well against Michigan State over the weekend, and they played Dickinson with Reed Jr. out there, and I think you're going to see a lot more of that lineup. I liked it. You saw a little bit from Will Cheddar coming in, making some plays with some set shot threes and a set shot elbow J, and he had one blocked off the glass. It was the right call. It was a goaltending, but him pitching in from the bench, and you like to see that bench points. But you know, the second half, Michigan, you know, they're up five with seven left, and they're, you know, they're down just to a 2-point lead with six remaining. But then they made a few plays. Duck McDaniel hit some big shots, and Michigan is up 5 points with 2 minutes to play. And then, around 2 minutes to play, they're up seven with 2:18 left. And you got to win a game when you're up seven with 2:18 left. You know, they turned the ball over a couple times. Bufkin, twice in this game, stepped on the baseline. I don't know. He had one that he got away with against Michigan State. That's going to happen once in a while. But when it happens three times in two games, you need a little bit of court awareness there. Sorry, Kobe. He had his best dunk in a Michigan uniform in the first half. And then Kobe Bufkin hit a big shot with 29 seconds left. It put Michigan up four. I mean, you're just parachuting in on this one. And I say, hey, Michigan was up four with 29 seconds to go. That's a great position to be able to get a road victory. But then a four-point play with 20.7 seconds, and then Michigan did get the final shot. And it went to Doug McDaniel, who missed the winning drive at the buzzer. So we went to overtime. You could say, well, why didn't they get it to Jett? Why didn't they get it to Dickinson? They tried to do that. Iowa cranked up the defense. Got to credit Iowa for playing good defense on Jett late in this game, and then definitely in overtime. They were crowding him. They were on him. They were playing good defense, as mentioned. So then we went to overtime, and anticlimactic, but it was. Iowa takes a 6-point lead in the first 2 minutes, and I think they scored. Oh, I don't have to think. I was keeping track of it. They scored the first 8 points of the overtime to get up 86-79. Finally, Michigan with Terrence TW2 got Michigan's bucket, with under 2 minutes to go. But an 8-point lead with 2:32, and that was all she wrote. Dickinson missed the front end of a one-on-one. Chris Murray came down. He hit both of his free throws there. You know, there's a 4-point swing where, you're sitting here talking about maybe 4 points. It's manageable with 2:32 to go, but that is what ended up doing Michigan in. Dooney Dunn says, Juwan's in-game decisions and lineups leave a lot to be desired. You know, when you lose a game and, you know, Michigan's playing, I think, a little bit below expectations, you're going to look at that. I think about, and sure, I'm not sitting here saying, oh man, Juwan, man, he's pulling all the right, because he's not. You know, when you're a little bit below where you expect to be, you're going to look at the coach and say you're not, you know, pulling all the right strings and putting all the guys in the right position in your lineups and all of that. So not like I'm over here sitting and saying it's great. I did like, as mentioned, having both Reed and Dickinson out there at the same time. And in Juwan's defense, now he put this team together, so you could say, hey, what the heck? But, you know, he's tinkering with different combinations off the bench and trying to find something. He hadn't really been able to get anything, you know, off the bench. I mentioned Cheddar, who had 7 points, and, you know, he was out there. But, you know, you're not getting enough of, Joey Buckets. You're not getting enough production from him, and you're not really getting a whole lot from the bench. Terrace Reed comes in. But other than that, they're searching for some scoring off the bench, and they don't really seem to have it. You know, at times, watching them tonight, I'm saying, hey, man, this team's clicking. They're coming around. Look at this scoring. Look at the way Dickinson and Jett are playing with each other. Kobe Bufkin coming around. Doug McDaniel at times makes some big shots, and you're thinking, hey, you know, TW2, you know, he needs to contribute a little bit more. But, you know, at times here watching tonight, I mean, they were very close for us sitting here talking about them winning their biggest game of the year, even though it was Iowa. I'm not putting Iowa in, like, you know, the Final Four or anything, but it was a road Big Ten game. It would have been their biggest win of the year. You want to argue Pitt, you know, on a neutral site? All right. Maryland at home? Okay. You know, all right. One of their biggest wins. I would have given it to them here. But I hear you on the combinations. I don't know what you want to see more of. You know, they've got a starting – they have a starting four. And even though he's my favorite player, Terrence Williams the second is a lot of times when they're playing offense, they're playing 4-on-5. He doesn't really have the kind of offense that is needed when you're talking about being a starting player in the Big Ten. He'd be a nice player to bring off the bench. You know, if he has it, he has it. If he doesn't, you know, you leave him there. But, you know, they are forced to start him. And, you know, that's one of the issues with this team, that, you know, he has to be out there. They've got four, I'd say, legit starters. Nothing against my favorite player. And, you know, at times he stepped up, but, you know, that's what I see. So then you're saying in-game decisions and lineups. I mean, I don't know who else you want to throw in there. They don't really have when you say you just have, you know, four guys to start and you don't have much of a bench, I mean, you've got about just four players, really, that you can count on. Now, I like Terrace Reed Jr. He's coming along. He's earning some minutes. Maybe they'll start playing him, starting him, and they will have TW2 coming off the bench. Maybe, but it just they just don't really have the team. You know, you don't really have the horses that way. So, you know, that's what I see. Okay. Let's get some more feedback. This one coming in from P. Maxis says, they don't seem to gel together. It was Jett Howard in the first half, and it should have been Hunter in the second half. I got to say this about Hunter Dickinson. He's got to play better. Hunter Dickinson, when Michigan is shooting like they are from downtown, you know, he should be able to get to the basket with, you know, single coverage and, you know, maybe to exert his will and get out there and score. He's not being strong enough with the basketball. At times it looks like he turns and he's surprised that guys are like crowding him, and then he like fumbles the ball, or that they're grabbing the ball from him. Other times he seems like, you know, he's 7-1. He's bringing it down to the, you know, the smaller defenders, and they're taking it away from him, or they're knocking it away. But a lot of times he just looks like he goes to make his move, and then he's fumbling out of bounds. I don't know if that's hand strength. I don't know if it's an agility situation there, but he needs to do better. I think I'll give it a blanket statement that he needs to be stronger with the ball when he has it. And I know that they see that. They watch the film. He watches it himself. And a better feel around the basket when guys are with him, make his move quicker, you know, those kind of things. But just too much sloppy play from Hunter Dickinson. So you might want him to be able to do all that and take control. He just has not been able to. And he's all right. You know, he's Michigan's best overall player. Jett Howard's their best scorer. I mean, he proved that again tonight. But, you know, they need Hunter Dickinson to play better if this team wants to go to the tournament. I think we all knows that. Where's Baker, the so-called sharpshooter from Duke? Yeah, that hasn't worked out. You know, Joey Buckets, you're hoping to get a lot more from and have him be somebody. You know, he came in, stepped into a nice open three, but that was it from him, you know. And that's all she wrote. Speaking of those numbers, let's get to those numbers for the game. And for that, you start out with Jett Howard's career night. Jed Howard had 34 points on 12 of 22 shooting and 7 of 13 from downtown. He scored the first 11 points of the game for Michigan. He had 21, matching his career high in the first half, and he had a hell of a game. Down the stretch, they needed another bucket or two from him late in this game and early in overtime. He wasn't able to deliver there, but, you know, hard to criticize 34 points. Doug McDaniel, he's a fun player to watch. He's got a big heart, and he is not afraid of the moment. He had a chance to win this game in regulation, driving the lane, and he wasn't able to get it to go. Struggled from the floor with a 5 of 15 performance, 12 points, 6 boards, 7 assists for the freshman from D.C. in Doug McDaniel. But I like him, and I like his game. Hunter Dickinson did not have his best game. 12 points, 13 boards, double-doubles are nice. 5 of 6 field goals. You need more from Hunter Dickinson if this team's going to make the tournament. They say bottom line. It does feel like the bottom line, though, that they need more from Hunter Dickinson. They should have had this game. Kobe Bufkin's game's been ascending. He did not have his best game tonight. 4 of 11 from the field, 1 of 5 from downtown. A lot of clean looks there for Kobe Bufkin as well. Did have a sweet dunk in the first half. And did have that key bucket with 29 seconds to go, which had Michigan with a 4-point lead and in a great position to win this game, but it didn't happen. 9 points for Bufkin. TW2, already mentioned him being in the starting lineup, and, you know, that's one of the problems with this team. They just don't have real five legit starters, and TW2 is forced to be in there. 5 points, 4 boards, 2 assists for TW2. Bill Cheddar, set shot Cheddar, knocked one in from downtown. Hey, earned some more minutes, earned some more shots, 3 of 3 for the field. 7 points for Cheddar. Joey Buckets didn't get much burn. I don't know if he played at all in the second half. Maybe check, see if there was some kind of issue with him, you know, because he stepped into his first three, and it was pure, and then that was it. Had one other shot. Terrace Reed, I like. You know, you just look at the line score and you didn't watch the game. You said, what are you, 2 points, 7 boards, 1 of 4 field goals. What are you talking about? He had a little bit of that Hunter Dickinson problem tonight where, you know, he's a big man and he's got big hands and a wide back and a, you know, Big Ten body. But, you know, he keeps the ball down by the little guards and they're snatching it away from him and he's dropping it. Too many of those. It's going to happen once in a while, but he'll get better at that. I like him. He guarded Chris Murray tonight, the fabulous player from the Hawkeyes, and held his own a little bit. I thought he did a nice job, you know, in a couple spurts there, giving him a different look. So I like Reed Jr., but Michigan needs more from their bench, and they've got 4 starters. So, you know, that's where I'm at. We'll take some more feedback. Troy saying Ono sent out a tweet about Jet. Good for sports fans. We have a president who has interest. That's good. I wasn't following everything that Santa was saying tonight. I saw him send out a tweet about the football program earlier, and it's nice that he's following it up with the basketball program, Troy. And then one that is not like a riddle, you know, like we hope, you know, I don't know if it was a riddle. I'm a little frustrated about that part, but, you know, more on that later. Last one on the feedback, impressed with Terrace Reed. This is P. Maximus was impressed with the freshman from St. Louis. Says hustling, rebounding, defending. How do you feel about him and Hunter on the court together? I like it. Maybe they should make that the starting lineup with Reed Jr. in there and have TW2 coming off the bench. Like, I'm going to say it for now, probably the 5th time tonight. Michigan has got 4 starters. The TW2 in there is standing out. This isn't a, what do they say, standing out like a sore thumb? It's just standing out. This isn't a sore thumb. It's just my thumb. and they need more from the bench, and they need another starter. What would be nice is if TW2 would step it up, play a little bit better. But entertaining game. Just wasn't to be for Michigan tonight. They're not able to get it done. Let's look at some other things, including the upcoming schedule. And that upcoming schedule, it is brought to you by the Mason Blue Reviews. Good afternoon, Michigan football and basketball. That is at 1 o'clock weekdays right here. We talk about the latest in Michigan sports, whatever's going on at 1 o'clock. That'll be included tomorrow. And so will this game, as we'll mention it and put it in one of the couple things that we'll talk about after we have a night to sleep on it, able to look back and see if it's any, if we feel any different about this game coming up tomorrow. Let's look at that upcoming schedule. You've got Michigan, all those playoff games going on this weekend, but Michigan, they will play, I don't know if we have a starting time on that one or not. Let me check that. They did not have a starting time, but they might now when I put that up there. So let's just take a look. Northwestern coming up on Sunday. I would guess that that's going to be an early game. Hopefully it's not going to be being played when there's an NFL playoff game. Playoff? Because I'm not sure how many people will be watching it. I'm not even sure how much I'll be paying attention to that one, even though it's part of it. Here it is, noon. We do have it. That's okay. Michigan playing at noon as they will entertain Northwestern. I'm all right with that. There you go. And then a week from today, man, we'll be in the back half of January. Michigan will be at Maryland, a Terps team that I'm sure is going to be upset as they got run off the floor at the Chrysler Center to start out this new year. Maryland will be waiting for Michigan a week from today. That's the upcoming schedule. If you just wanted to think about a tournament check, a tournament resume, I'm starting to do that here in the new year. And we know it's a long ways away from March and everything else, but this is a good way to look at it. You got the Ken, this is a lot of ways. You can look at RPI. You can look at the overall record. Looking at just the Ken Palm rankings, it's a pretty good guide right now. And, you know, you're going to have to start putting the resume up and key wins and quad ones and all that. Michigan, the Big Ten is going to have 7 or 8 teams that are likely to make the NCAA tournament this year. If you just go by the Ken Palm rankings, Michigan is 10th in those Ken Palm ratings. So they're on the outside looking in. The good news is you put a good week or two together, get some wins, and you can move way up in Ken Palm. You can move way up in the Big Ten. That's the way it's done right now. You have Iowa as that, you know, well, I said 7 or 8. Iowa's at 7. Obviously, they'll be moving up a little bit with their W tonight. Michigan State, they got the win against Whiskey last night. They're doing all right now, making a little bit of a move there for Tom Izzo. And then you got Penn State and Michigan. Michigan at 50. Some of those games that they have coming up, there's Northwestern, 53. That's a game at home that you'd say Michigan, you know, you say they have to win. They don't have to win it. They probably should win it, you know, if they want to get something going and not have to, you know, get into February where you feel like, hey, they got to win more games now. They get a little bit of pressure on them. So I would say that's like, feels like one of those protect home court. You pretty much have to win that one. Then they'll have an opportunity to go play Maryland, a team that they played so well against to start the year out coming up a week from today. And, you know, that would be a nice quad one, nice road victory for the Wolverines if they're able to get that one. So that's how I see it. Invite everybody to come on in tomorrow. We'll talk about it there on the good afternoon, Michigan football and basketball. We got some late feedback coming in. Let's see Mitchell getting in here under the buzzer. He says, hey. Seems like Michigan is often on the losing end of these close games. Why do you think they haven't been able to execute late? Well, if we go game by game, you think about the Virginia game in a one-possession game. Virginia, a really good game. You know, you had that reach-in foul that ended up being an intentional foul on Jet. That was a mistake by the freshman. You think about the North Carolina game. I think that it's a tough part when you have the two players that you want to get to the ball to, Hunter Dickinson. You can't just pop Hunter Dickinson out and hand him the ball. You got to get him down in the post. You got to throw him the ball. And then if the other team, it's hard to kind of dictate things, and he's a hard player to go to in the closing minutes, because they're going to force the ball out of his hands and guys have to step up and hit shots. What I'm saying, it's tough when you're big and your center is a back to the basket type guy. And he's the guy that, you know, you want to get the ball to. Teams can deny him. They can run guys at him, get the ball out of their hands, and other guys have to step up, and they have not late in the games. That's what happened against Kentucky. That's what happened against North Carolina and Virginia. It was the same kind of stuff. It was like tonight, you know, like there was a couple of unforced errors. Actually, Michigan made the big play offensively with Bufkin, but then they gave up a 4-point play. What can you say about that? You know, basketball, in a lot of ways, is about under 5 minutes, certainly under 2 minutes in a tie game. Can you make plays? Can you make shots? Michigan has not been able to do that. That's what separates the good teams from the also-rans. And, you know, Michigan right now, if they don't start executing, you got to get yourself there. That's the first part. And they have been able to do that. But once you get there, that's what's going to separate you. Pouring in from downtown, double-doubles, that stuff's all great. Making the plays with under five, with under 2 minutes to go, making those big plays and being able to get the Ws, that's what good teams are able to do. So why haven't they been able to execute? Man, it comes down to the players not being able to hit the shots. And that starts with Hunter Dickinson. And, you know, it goes from to Jet Howard. Let's just talk about their best players. Kobe Bufkin. Those three, I would go to Doug McDaniel after that, and you're putting a lot on his shoulders as a freshman, but that's just where they're at right now. But I would go to their top three guys not being able to make the plays in crunch time. And so we just singled them out, and that's it. And I said that was it on the feedback, but PM is jumping in with one last final one. He thinks that Will Cheddar would be the fifth starter if he can score. He tries and hustles. TW2, Terrence Williams seems to be just out there. Maybe a shot here or there. Cheddar. Interesting. You know, the first step, and it's not a bad suggestion at all. I think it's a good suggestion. We've just seen him in the last game or two just get in there and start getting some burn off the bench. So I would say that you've got these next games against Northwestern and Maryland. Cheddar is certainly going to get an opportunity off the bench. I don't think they're going to put him into the starting lineup immediately. But let's say he goes out there and can do what he did tonight, hit open shots. You know, he's pouring it in a little bit, giving him a boost. Well, then you could take a look at it. And, you know, the tough part is like, you know, Cheddar's the redshirt freshman. TW2's a junior. You don't want to lose him. You know, totally, you don't want to say, you know, like send him to the bench and never see him again, you know, that kind of thing. So the delicate situations, we'll see how, you know, that ends up working out. All right. Thanks for joining us. We're here after every Michigan football and basketball game. And so that means we will be here Sunday after the Northwestern game. If you're around live weekdays at 1 o'clock, jump in on that Good Afternoon Michigan football and basketball show. We have a lot of fun kicking around the day's topics with Michigan sports. There's been a lot to talk about when it comes to the Wolverines. We don't have to force any topics. They're all right there, and they're real easy to come up with. Like tomorrow's, this will be one of the things, how to execute late in basketball games. We'll see you then. Everybody have a great night. Good night.